for our apportionment. And so you guys have heard me explain what the deficit factor is previously, but just real briefly, a majority of our apportionment, so of that total $106 million, $99 million of that comes through the FTES that is generated, and it's the state apportionment that the state provides. At any given time, when the state revenues do not come in as the state has budgeted them, they don't make up the difference for community colleges. Instead, what they do is apply a deficit factor. So when we closed the books a year ago for our 2012-13 books, the state had applied a deficit factor of 3.7%. Which is over $3 million, about $3.7 million is what the state had applied in June of 13. When the state did the recalculation and finalized our numbers for the 12-13 fiscal year in March of 14, so granted, this is 9 months after we've closed our books, the state recalculates what we actually received 9 months previously. They reduced that deficit factor down to 0.19%. So that is about a $3 million swing in our revenue directly related to the state financing and how they fund us. So that's really the majority of why we had a greater surplus than we had originally planned when we adopted the budget on the expenditures.
Would you mind pointing to which line item you're referring to?
Budget. The budget does not appear in here, so I'm just trying to give you a little bit of background. The only thing that's represented on this report are the actual numbers. And that's where I said at our meeting on September 9th, we'll go into more detail on that. But just trying to, as Board President Kellogg had asked me to explain why we have the $4 million surplus. That's what I was going into details on there. So on the total expenditure side, you know, our expenditures came in just about $500,000 less than what we had originally budgeted. And that's really just savings from the departments that kind of fall out at the end of the year. So I'll just open it up to any other questions that the board members may have.
So essentially with the state on their traditionally how they handled budgetary items, they came back, and we had to adjust accordingly, I'm hearing. All right.
Yeah, I had a question. If it's regarding this item 12.11, which I think I made a mistake in the question that I sent to you, can you go in detail? Maybe I'm not quite understanding the explanation. On how the district intends to fund the salary and benefit increases, and also identifying the revenue and the source and object code. There's a little blurb. If you can go into that, I'd appreciate it.
Right, so on this report, on the second page of the report under item Roman numeral 5, it asks if the district has settled any employee contracts during this quarter. So we responded yes. And so then what we did was we detailed out both the salaries and the benefits. So we have settled with the management team, and we have settled with the part-time faculty, the CHI union. And so the amounts, the cost of those settled agreements are represented by each fiscal year. Since it was a three-year agreement, we've detailed it out for each of the 3 years, the cost for each year on the salaries, as well as the cost for the benefits for each of the 3 years. And what we're explaining down below are the details of each of the agreements between the management team and the part-time faculty, the CHI.
But we haven't settled. When you say we've settled, we haven't settled.
We have. That's with the management team and with the part-time faculty. So okay. We've authorized the salary increases for the management team, which we authorized the same amount that was originally offered to every unit, and we have settled with the part-time faculty. And that contract was ratified at the last board meeting?
I understand the part-time, and I don't think the first one, the 2% on schedule, 2% off schedule, is that settled?
Yes, that was offered, that was provided to the managers and approved by the board.
Okay, so when you say settle, it wasn't settled with the party. It was just approved by the board. Is that what you mean? Because I don't think this has been settled.
It's agreed upon by the board.
Settled means with the negotiating party, and I don't think we're there yet, are we? Unless I'm missing.
At the management team, we are. And with the part-time faculty unit, we are.
Yeah.
And so those are the two units that were represented of the cost increases for those salary increases that we provided for those two units of employees. And what we say in here of how we're going to pay for those salary increases is that we're going to pay for it with any increased apportionment revenue or prior year budget savings that may come through to the district. And when we say increased apportionment revenue, that would either be through COLA or through growth funding that may be received.
So is this subject to change?
No.
No.
Interesting.
Trustee Baxter.
Sure. Does these figures reflect the increase that we're going to pay in the benefits, the STRS benefits and the PERS benefits?
No, these amounts are only related to the salary increases that were provided. It does not include the statutory increase on the STRS and PERS.
Well, then what does benefits mean?
So the benefits would be the employer provided, so it's your Social Security, it's your Medicare,
those
types of things.
So I'm real clear on this. We had a negotiation with the part-time faculty. We came to an agreement. Both sides agreed. That agreement was adopted by the board. And now the numbers reflected in that agreement have been removed from the reporting, or reported in the reporting requirement. We had a negotiation with the management group.
We technically don't negotiate with management. We meet and confer. We essentially prepare a proposal for the board on behalf of management, which in this case, there was very little negotiation or discussion, because the board's preference was to give every employee unit the same offer.
Okay. So, but then that was approved. And now that's been removed as well. And that's the process.
I don't think it's removed. That's my question was. It's shown here.
It's shown as a number that we've decided upon, because the process is complete. It's over.
Yeah, that's where you guys lose me, but.
Ask it afterwards.
Trustee, the purpose of this report is so that the Chancellor's Office can review the finances of the districts on a quarterly basis. So in any given point when contract negotiations are settled with any unit, the state wants to know, they want you to calculate what the cost of that salary increase is, the related benefits, which are the employer paid statutory benefits that are charged against salaries, and show those expenses so that the state can monitor to ensure that the districts aren't giving raises more than they can afford based upon the financial information that's provided. So that's why they ask for the 3 years, the detail of what the cost is of those salaries, the related benefits, and what the percentages are, and how the district is planning to pay for those raises. So that's the purpose of that question and why we show the 3-year history.
When is this report due?
The report is due August 31st.
Yeah. All right, any other questions on this state report? All right, was there a motion? I'm sorry. There's a motion and a second on the floor. Any other discussion at this time? Hearing none, Madam Secretary, please call the roll.
President Kellogg?
Aye.
Vice President Otto?
Aye.
Member Baxter?
Aye.
Member Zia?
Aye.
Thank you. Item carries. Pacific Coast Campus, no items, no report at this time. College Advancement, Economic Development, no items to report out. Reports and Communications. Academic Senate President?
Yes, I have a report.
Thank you.
And it gives me great pleasure to spend the time allotted to my report to Dr. David Morse, who was already introduced earlier this evening. But as you all know, he is our statewide Academic Senate president, and he is here this evening to give us some updates on what's happening around the state. So it's my pleasure to have my friend and colleague, David, join us this evening.
Good evening, David.
Evening. Thank you, Karen. And good evening, President Kellogg, President Oakley, and board members. It's late, so I will try to make this fairly brief, isn't it? But having sat through this whole thing, I don't want to leave without at least saying hello. And having given you at least a brief update, as you know, I had two reasons for requesting this time from Karen. The first, again, just to give you a little update on the things that the State Academic Senate is working on. We are very involved with the statewide initiatives that are happening involving common assessment, online education, and educational planning. There are some struggles that go on with those, especially in my mind, because they are frequently characterized as technology initiatives, and we keep having to remind people that common assessment first is in about assessing students. It's not about letting the technology drive it. And secondly, that although we all agree that students should have educational plans, technology is not going to solve that. We need to actually have counseling professionals to be able to do that. So there are some complications, but we're moving those things forward in what I think are positive ways. We're also, of course, still very involved with curricular activities like the course identifier system and the development of the transfer degrees, of which we now have over 1,400 in place statewide. So we have, over the past few years, made huge progress in that area. We also are doing a lot of work putting together, first off, our own plan for the Academic Senate in terms of equity, diversity, and cultural competence, but also helping colleges in that area because of the equity plans and because of the equity funding coming from the state in that area. So doing a lot of work in that area. Also, of course, on professional development, which is currently a fairly big push from the Chancellor's office, and so trying to help in various ways with the faculty end of our professional development efforts. So we're doing a lot of things, of course, and we have a 14-member elected board, of which, yes, I've served on that board for the last 6 years, and this year was elected to serve as president. Again, all 14 of our members are elected, and we cannot do our job without the support of our districts. In fact, I was having a conversation on the way here with one of our board members who is getting trouble from her college president because she's gone from campus so much at this point. I don't have that problem. Eloy seems to be very happy when I've gone from campus, whatever, you know, possible. So that...
Do you want a motion?
No. But that was my second reason for coming in, is because in all seriousness, I have always been supported by our district, by this board, always by President Oakley, by the various vice presidents sitting here, by my deans, by department chairs, really by everyone having supported my work, both with enthusiasm and encouragement, which I absolutely appreciate, but also with helping to make any accommodations that I needed to be able to make in order to do the job that I do. So I wanted to stop by and say thank you to the board and to the district for that support, and for by supporting me for supporting the State Academic Senate. And finally, just to say that although I'm elected to represent the faculty at all 112 of our colleges, and I'm not there to represent Long Beach City College, but I do still get a paycheck that says Long Beach City College on it. So, and I am conscious of that. So if there is at any point anything that I can offer to you and help with in terms of information, things that we are working on, things that are going on at the state level, I would certainly be happy to come in and try to share that with you and try to help you out. So, and I'm happy to try to answer any questions on Academic Senate activities, but other than that, I just wanted to thank you for your support.
Thank you. Your term is what, 2 years?
It's a one-year term with a two-term limit. So, the expectation would be that I serve 2 years, but then again, you never know who I'm going to annoy along the way, so yeah. You never know.
No, I think we can anticipate you being away for 2 years. You do great work. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Karen, is that all this time?
Yes.
All right. Moving on, Superintendent President Report.
Yes, thank you, Board President Kellogg, and I will also try to be brief and to add to the Love Fest with the Statewide Academic Senate. I also want to thank David. He brought the Academic Senate Executive Committee for a retreat, and Dr. Long and I had the pleasure of welcoming them onto campus. So thank you, David. Couple of just brief reports. First of all, welcome back to all of our students. This is the second day of the academic year. And thank you to all the faculty and staff who are working hard to ensure our students are prepared for the semester. We kicked off the academic year last Friday with College Day. Thank you to all who came and participated in the various events. I think it was a wonderful day to kick off the academic year. Thank you to all the trustees for coming by as well. Also want to, again, welcome all of our new faculty, all 55 of them, plus all of the classified management team members that are new to the college. Thank you for choosing Long Beach City College, and look forward to working with everyone. And since this is... and I don't know if it's her fault that we're still here after 8, but I want to welcome Dr. Terry Long. This is her first meeting as the Vice President of Academic Affairs. When she was hired, she assured me that we would have shorter board meetings. But any case, welcome, Terry. And then finally, well, two things. So one is I do want to express... that our student trustee had to leave, and he did leave behind a report that Dr. Peterson has. So after I'm done, if the board would like to hear student trustee Root's report, we can certainly make that happen. And then finally, very excited and proud to welcome Superintendent of Public Instruction Torlakson tomorrow. He's coming to Long Beach City College specifically to highlight the Career Pathways Trust and the proposal that we were awarded. He will be here tomorrow to take a tour and interview with our architectural design instructors, as well as our industrial electricity class. Those are the two programs that he is highlighting as part of the Career Pathways Trust. So again, we're happy, excited, and honored that the superintendent will be here with us and he will have a chance to continue to talk about the Career Pathways Trust and the great work that it's doing to advance career and college readiness throughout California. That's my report.
All right, next is the student trustee report. David had to leave for work, so at this time, Vice President Peterson, would you like to...
I can read his remarks.
Thank you. Please do so.
The start of the 2014 fall semester began Monday, August 25th, considerably well despite the added confusion with the navigation of the construction at the Pacific Coast campus, as well as the Liberal Arts campus. PCC set up two information booths to assist students with direction, as well as information on services such as financial aid and where to obtain ID cards. Student ambassadors and managers manned a booth centered in the quad and a similar booth in front of the library, just left of the bookstore and student union. The ASB Student Council Leadership Retreat was held on Friday, August 15th and Saturday, August 16th at the MHA Village in downtown Long Beach. Friday's agenda was filled with group activities and leadership discussions, as well as an appearance of our Board of Trustees Vice President Doug Otto, who emphasized that what the Board of Trustees is and actually does for our school, as well as what it means to be an effective student leader and the importance of these positions. Also on Friday, Vice President Gregory Peterson and Dean of Student Affairs Connie Sears were in attendance to also reiterate what student leadership and governance means to not just us, but also the students at LBCC. Renee Castro, a social worker with Building Healthy Communities in Long Beach, was the workshop facilitator for the Friday's workshop, teaching the finer points on how to be effective and fair in our roles. Saturday's agenda was geared more towards the proper way to run a student council and ASB meeting, as according to Robert's Rules of Order. Bruce Bishop, a certified parliamentarian, was the workshop facilitator for this day's instruction, focusing on such topics as quorum and what makes up a quorum, the proper, I think it's quorum, what makes up a quorum, the proper way to make and second a motion, and how to run an effective election, and how to properly campaign, and what not to do as well. Wednesday, August 27th, both the ASB and Student Council will be holding a recruitment information day at both LAC and PCC from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. The PCC booth will be in front of the MM building and a health and information booth adjacent to the bookstore, and the health LAC tables will be in front of the A building or between the A building and the Student Life Center. Trustee Root states, I just want to touch on how the new ASB cabinet and the Student Council has worked diligently with the administration and staff at LBCC and is one of the strongest student bodies I have seen since my enrollment at LBCC in the fall of 2012. Never before has both administration and student leaders worked as such a team to reach a common goal in serving the students. I am approached daily and given praise for the extra effort I and my fellow student leaders have put in to break down the walls and barriers that have been in place for the past 2 years with the Board of Trustees and the administration. I vow to continue working on the relationship that has blossomed due to the hard work and dedication for success by me and my student leader colleagues. Finally, we can put our differences aside and focus on the true task at hand, which is the school and restoring Viking pride. Go Vikings.
Thank you. All right, very good. Board of Trustee members.
I have comments. A report.
As is trustees, yeah.
Yes, I'd just like to give a couple of updates, but before I do, I just wanted to congratulate our new hires and welcome them. I know we have quite a number of new hires, also Terry Long, Sylvia Lynch, Kenneth Starkman, Alan Maloney, Noel Correll, if I'm pronouncing his name correctly, who's in the audience. Many classified new hires and the faculty new hires. I am so excited. I try to talk to most of you during the college day and introduce myself, but I had to go back to work. So I look forward to meeting all of you. And I plan on having a monthly coffee session to meet our staff, and I hope you can come to the session. And my information is posted on the website. You have direct access to me, and I'd love to hear from you and get to know you. I'd also like to report on Trustee Baxter and myself, and we've coordinated this. And Trustee Baxter, if you want to chime in at any time, feel free to. I'd like to report on our trip, our conference to Washington, D.C., that was encouraged by our old board members on this board. It was a fascinating and just amazing conference. And I also like to acknowledge our superintendent who recommended this conference. So a couple of takeaways from this conference. Was there a question? Or, okay. Perhaps a sidebar. So one of the things that they really emphasized was the common theme for the mission of community colleges, and that's open access, workforce development, and being a community driver. They also emphasize, and I feel that it's perhaps ironic that the timing is tonight, that it's don't be a board that operates as a country club. Monitor expenditures closely and ensure proper use of funding. Help raise money for the college. So I look forward to working with Trustee Baxter and helping raise money for this fine district. Also, they emphasized the role of trustees to nourish, guide, and provide comfort and help shift the conversation to set the tone and leaving a legacy. The best legacy you can leave is an economic benefit to the community and students. And I tend to agree. The other thing that came up, which was very interesting, was a strategic plan. And I've asked for the plan, and I'd like to review the plan that we have. And one of the things that they emphasized was that the strategic plan be forward-looking versus a status quo plan. And they also emphasized that the best plans are they need to be less than 6 months old at the time of the accreditation visit. So for us, that would mean shouldn't be older than April 2014, since our accreditation team is coming in October, based on my understanding. They talked about the responsibilities and the purpose of the board and setting policies. They also said, don't be a rogue trustee. Whenever possible, work with the board and CEO to confront problems, and that a rogue trustee is not equivalent to asking difficult difficult questions and challenging the district to be better. Again, I feel like this is just all stars are aligned for tonight's meeting. And always challenging the district to be better and don't be on cruise control. The other item that came up was making sure we fulfill on our fiduciary duty, following the money and the outcomes. For example, what are the value of our expenditures that are spent in the district? What kind of value do they provide to the district? Other fiduciary duties besides financial piece is risk management. So I've asked for the our insurance and just from a legality standpoint. And the other item that they brought up is looking at guarantee for services paid for students and productivity and success. And every decision we make should be based on what's in the best interest of the students, which was amazing to hear. The other role of the trustee would be coordinating, focusing on coordinating with other colleges on legislature, best practice, modeling successful models, and review of universities and other colleges for academic quality. And they spent quite a bit of time that it was fascinating to see how some of the other districts worked together or model successful model, or they had examples of public-private partnerships, which would be interesting to get examples of. Perhaps we can model. The other items that came up was advocacy, as the importance of lobbying Congress for financial aid for our students, which was really great to hear, and I look forward to working on that with the board members here. Also, I mentioned the public-private partnership. There was quite a bit of discussion on accreditation that was really noteworthy, and it was really eye-opening for myself. I don't know about you, Trustee Baxter, if you want to speak to that, but it was interesting. One common theme that I heard from other districts, so this conference had trustees from all over the states, and it was interesting to see how they operate, and the common denominator was that they have new trustee orientation. And I think it would be great if we can work on a model for our new trustees, and especially for an appointment, the appointee in the next couple of months. And they also talked about that the new trustees would have mentors on the board. So that was an interesting point. They also mentioned the other thing that came up was don't ignore labor negotiations and impasse. And this, in the second day, there was a financial presentation that was just fascinating. With this gentleman, Brad Young. But then again, you know, I love finance. So one of the things that he mentioned, these are takeaways. There was a lot of things discussed at this conference. It was really, really great. He mentioned to audit the financial aid office, and that's something that I think it would be great to look at. There was a lot of discussion about scrutinizing spending and making sure there's an explanation column in our budget books and getting monthly board updates on the budget. So I thought that was great, and I would certainly welcome that at our district, and we'll work towards that with the rest of my board members. I'd like to give it to the board secretary so that we notice it and give it to our staff and whoever would like to use this information. The other thing that was really fascinating that came up was that there should be no revenues for bookstores. So it should be a break-even model, so not making money off of your students. And that was a little interesting and a learning point for me. And focusing on what needs to be done to make books affordable, and that was a big emphasis. I certainly like to look at that and see how we can optimize what we currently have. And just really focusing on how are we going to benefit the students. The other item that came up, which was interesting, was making sure we address IT controls. So I don't know if we currently do that at the at our district, information technology controls, and making sure apparently there's quite a bit of fraud and abuse nationwide, and I'd certainly like to see what we're doing there, and operationalize the capital projects for maintenance and replacement work, like carpet, people to operate facilities, those kind of efforts. And they also talked about typically a contract for district president should be a maximum of 3 to 5 years, and the contract should entail expectations and board measures, such as looking at enrollment, how we're doing in enrollment and baked into the contract, and remedial education process for evaluating all the staff. And that would be one of the performance measures. And then the last day, it was interesting to see a discussion on online courses versus conventional courses. And that was just absolutely fascinating, the different dynamics and the pros and cons. And the biggest takeaway that I, along with Trustee Baxter, we had was to assess it based on specific need and circumstances. Shouldn't be all or nothing, and really look at that. And there was a presentation made by a gentleman with Inside Higher Ed, and how to work with the media. That was really interesting. And one of the things that came up was that our website should indicate what are our top three programs. And I think that was really great. And I certainly would want to learn a little bit more about that. Other things that he mentioned, which was really great, was how does our district fit in the ecosystem of education? Who are the employers who employ our students? What's the correlation with high school grads and four-year university graduates? And monitor where our students come from, where they go. I thought that was great. Also, it would be great to get reporters in our classrooms where the magic happens. That was one of the things that was the takeaway on the third day. The gentleman emphasized how journalists love stories that address the problem with a solution. We had a problem, and here's how we fixed it. And the driver is transparency. And the other thing that he mentioned was, like, you know, if I can't find your president's contract within 30 seconds of going on your website, that's a red flag for me, which was a little bit surprising to me that that's the kind of stuff they look for. And in his words, it's the biggest red flag of hiding the ball and indicator for lack of transparency. That again, was interesting to hear and surprising, particularly for me. They look at those kind of items. So I would definitely, I have also brought a case study packet that they gave us. I thought it was great. It looks at a lot of the stuff that we may be talking about our board retreat, like broadcasting the board meetings, and also looking at the regional standards for accreditation and other topics were like from cruise control to needing a new roadmap. That was an interesting case study that was done. And then the other takeaway was emphasis on monitoring the travel expenditure of the board and asking for the budget and actual expenditure. And I spent quite a bit of time understanding what the instructor was referring to on the case studies that she gave us to read. And it was very clear to set up a policy that is clear so each member knows the confines for this item and need to be looked at closely. So having seen this case study and some of the great points that were raised in the conference, I asked what our board travel budget is and was told it's $25,000. I then asked for last year's expenditure and was told we spent $29,072. So I wanted to naturally beg the question of, like, why did we go over? And I further asked for the itemized expenditures for each trustee for 2013 and 2014, and I was questioned on why I'm requesting this information and what the concern is. I asked for this information as part of my oversight and fiduciary duty to this district and the public as a trustee. And the situation of going over budget is an example of why we need to look at this information and learn from our past errors, and if there are any, in order to better manage our expenditures. Not only was I not given this information, but I was told by our board president the request, which we all know is the entitlement of the public under the Public Records Act, is inappropriate and it is denied. It is unfortunate that I have to bring this up, but I feel that it is the public's right to know how their money is spent, and also in my oversight capacity as a trustee, and I refuse to look the other way and let this slide. Thank you. That concludes my report.
Can I just say, I promise I'll be 10 seconds. I just wanted to thank the college for sending Trustee Zia and I to Washington, D.C. It was a great learning experience. The person who coordinated our 3 days had special recognition for President Oakley, which I was very impressed with. And she has been a past community college president and now works for the ACCT. So thank you for sending me.
Thank you. Other members of the board on items. Just to clarify, the request was because I always, for the board, it's a board action, board request, board information, and not an individual requesting from our staff, and that's why it was denied. Very simple. So it's, again, learning how a board operates as in a way that's effective. And so, but it is public information. But anyway.
Well, I certainly welcome the public, any member of the public, to put in a public record request and get this information.
Sure. So, but nonetheless, no other reports from members of the board. There's also no trustee committees. So at this time, there's no public comments on non-agenda items, correct, Madam Secretary? None? Then we will adjourn to a second closed session for further discussion on the items listed under closed session items. And then we'll return after that. So at this time, the meeting of the Board of Trustees is adjourned. To closed session.